about the harmonization of the legislation in the region. I presume you meant the ECU and not the wider Caribbean. So hence my question that probably expands to June as well, which is, what about the overall region when you talk about one economic space, since that is the intent? Where are we with all these countries going through this reform process in terms of the either the regulators and or the politicians reviewing this to ensure that there is harmonization of the legislation? And in particular, I like your comment about the portability across the islands, which is absolutely essential if we really want to create one economic space.
Good day. The seminar speaks about the future of the pension industry. I just wanted to ask the panel, Tim, James, Charles, about the future of occupational pension schemes. James, we spoke about the fines and the, who wants to be a trustee. We spoke about companies, sponsoring companies, probably indemnifying trustees. So at the end of the day, the fines are going to fall squarely on sponsoring companies. So who wants to be a sponsoring company of an occupational pension scheme? Charles, there was a question with the Barbados Pension Act as to a number of plans wanting to close the funds. What is your feedback? It may have lowered the fines right now, as you indicated, with that threat of occupational pension fees being terminated. What is the feedback since then as far as the re-registration of the pension plans with these occupational pension schemes?
Do we have any other questions in this round?
Good day to everyone. Just for the speakers from Trinidad and Tobago, in terms of getting an overview as to what has been the process adopted in terms of stakeholder consultation, who have been the main stakeholders in terms of the proposed legislation, and generally what has been the feedback?
One question more relevant now specifically to Trinidad and Tobago. To what extent in the pension reform are we looking to ensure that both the private and the public sector pension issues are looked at to ensure that there could be portability between the public sector pension and the private sector, particularly where the public sector is an unfunded plan?
We'll take the last question for this first round.
Great. I just want to follow up on the question with regards to the consultation. In Trinidad and Tobago, two of the largest pension plans, the sponsors have recognized majority unions as fundamental parts of the management committees. And therefore, in pension reform in this jurisdiction, it is important that the workers themselves, who believe fundamentally the funds that the pension plan belong to, should be allowed to have some say in the future pension plan legislation. I would like to hear the views of the two representatives from this country as to why it is the unions were not part of the consultation process, particularly in the context that the public consultations are now over, and why it is that this important stakeholder has been left out of the process.
Okay, so we start to respond to this first round of questions, and possibly, James, could we start with you, and I'll ask each of the presenters to respond.
Well, let me just first of all cover the consultation process. The initial proposal came out, I believe, in October or thereabouts of last year, and there was consultation in December. I know for sure that trustees and sponsoring companies were invited. I'm not sure the position of the unions. I don't know if Tim might know if they were invited, but certainly, as far as I know, they're supposed to be invited. But certainly, there was consultation back in December of last year. All right. In terms of the private and public sector, certainly the Act covers occupational pension plans. It doesn't really cover the public sector at all. Okay, as such.
I suspect the question was actually more why weren't union people invited to be on the review committee? Yeah? That's a question you'd have to address to the central bank. I mean, I was invited to come on, but I wasn't involved in choosing who was on it. The actual process of consultation is actually the proposals that were issued in last October with a second go-round. The first set of proposals were issued, I think it was about the 14th of December 2010, and then there was a consultation process that ran up to the end of April 2011, where various people made written submissions, and then that process went round again. If I could just very quickly comment on the questions as well. I've done like questions 3 and 5 there, I think. First one, harmonisation of CARICOM pensions legislation. I mean, over the years, we've had a number of clients who operate in multiple countries, and what is really needed is that you're able to operate one pension plan that covers multiple jurisdictions, which various bits of legislation, particularly Trinidad's, actually gets in the way of that. So, for example, you'll see organisations that operate around the Caribbean, they have a pension plan that covers a number of territories, but they have to have a separate one for Trinidad. So a lot of that is actually is to do with tax as much as anything else. So it's partially a tax issue, not just a central bank or the equivalent regulator issue. But if we're serious about having a single economic space, you need companies that operate across the region need to be able to send staff to go and work in Guyana for 3 years, in Jamaica for 5 years, and then Barbados for a bit, and then return back home and retire in Trinidad and have a single vehicle that provides them with their pension. I mean, I'm not suggesting it's straightforward, but it's something that needs to be addressed. Roger asked about the future occupational pension schemes. So I mean, how long have you got? But I mean, my take on it is that I've been in this business over 30 years now, and things go in cycles. There's quite a bit of fashion in what sort of benefits you're providing to people and how you provide them. But underlying that, there's always going to be retired people and they're always going to need income. So there is a future for occupational pension plans, most definitely, but they just might not look like the way they look now in 10 years' time. But you did ask about fines. I don't actually see the fines under the proposed Occupational Pension Plans Act as a big deal anymore. Under the first proposals, they were a very big deal, because initially it was suggested that management committee members would be subject to fines for all sorts of things that they weren't under their control. And when in fact, as management committee members, their full-time job wasn't running the pension plan. So management committee members could have been fined for all sorts of stuff. In the second set of proposals, the central bank actually listened to people who said, we won't sit on a management committee if this is there, and it was largely taken away. There's only one fine left in the proposals for management committees, and that, I've been told, is an error. So when the final set of proposals come along, there should be no fines at all for management committee members. Once that's out of the way, I don't think there's a problem. I think the fines just then become a management issue, and it's down to people to make sure they run the pension plans properly. So if trustees don't do things properly, they incur a fine. If a trustee incurs a fine because an actuary has been delinquent in, say, producing a valuation report, I'm sure there's going to be a contractual relationship that says I've got to write them a check for $100,000. Similarly, if we don't produce a valuation report because the sponsoring employer hasn't provided data, then ultimately people are going to look to the employer to be reimbursed. And that's why I didn't get time to talk about the slide, but that's why I had a slide talking about much more detailed contractual arrangements between the different players. So I don't actually see that as a big issue, Roger. I think as long as you manage it properly and run your business properly, I don't see that as a big deal.
On the issue of fees, once the fees had been addressed, we've not seen any major threat of plans terminating. So I think the responsiveness of the regulator, when they get something that's out of sync with the industry, to respond to it and respond to it quickly is very important. And we did get that response, and I think that immediate threat is gone. I think the devil is always in the detail. You can have regulations that seem perfectly reasonable, and then you can have a regulator that implements them in a totally unreasonable way. I mean, I've seen one Caribbean country where you have to file a SIP. Seems like a very reasonable requirement, but suddenly the regulator is requiring not only the SIP, but they want all the studies and cash flow projections that were used in coming up with the SIP, and they want to enter into a six-month discussion every year on how you develop the SIP. And so, you know, I think regulation can go to a stage where it will just become so difficult that people will say, to hell with it, let's have a simple defined contribution scheme, or let's have no scheme at all. So I think what I like to say is that regulators always need to remember that, in fact, one primary objective of legislation is to encourage the formation of pension plans. If we, in fact, have wonderful regulations and no plans, then we really haven't met the objective, which is to have pensions for our population. And I think that needs to be always put number one. If regulations aren't actually encouraging the formation of pension plans, are they in balance good regulation?
Let's go to Mario.
I'm sure that there are people in the room who would have a lot more information on the harmonization of pension plans across the region. Certainly, within the OECS, one tries to harmonize within the grouping, and in addition to try to dock in as much as possible with what prevails at the wider CARICOM level. I've heard the notion of reciprocity, I will, if you do the same, and so on. But I'm not up to date on what the current position is. Thank you.
Let's just go back to, I think, Tim, to address the question on portability. And although as the moderator, I am trying my best to stay out of the conversation, since Douglas has addressed those questions specifically to me, I will give a brief response. My longer response will be done directly to him.
Yeah, sorry, Douglas. I did write down your question then, and I forgot to answer it. Portability between private and public pension arrangements, the legislation is there. It's Act number 20 of 1997, modified the Pensions Act to allow transfer between occupational pension plans and the Pensions Act, so central public service. So it's been there on the statute books, but no one on the government side has got round to working out how they would do it. It is the basic problem. The idea that the issue you raised, that the Pensions Act pensions are unfunded and occupational plans are funded, it actually isn't an obstacle at all. They've had the same position in the UK for Lord knows how many years. The actual funding is unimportant. What is, when you're moving in either direction, what is important is what the British pension industry would call the strength of covenant, i.e. if you're in an occupational pension plan and you go and work for the Ministry of Finance and your pension plan pays across some money to the government and it disappears into the consolidated fund, how strong is the government's promise that they will pay you your benefit? So that's the key thing. It's not the fact that there's a fund there, it's the fact that there's a government and it can tax people. Going in the opposite direction, if someone goes from the central public service and goes to work for Guardian Life, for example, and the government pays across a transfer payment to transfer pension liabilities, someone should be asking, well, how strong is the covenant in the Guardian Life pension scheme, which is down partial to how well it's funded and also to the strength of the company that ultimately stands behind it. So it's more to do with strength of covenant than funding or not. I find a lot of discussions about portability in Trinidad aren't actually about portability at all. Portability does exist. The mechanisms are there to move from one pension plan to another, to deferred annuities, to public sector arrangements. What is more of an issue isn't can you walk with your benefit, it's what benefit have you got to walk with. So the benefits for people who leave mid-career are generally pretty poor. So you can take it with you, but that won't make you a whole lot better off. And there have been all sorts of reports written for government over the years about portability. I myself wrote one about 25 years ago, which is probably terribly naive given how young I was at the time. But everything is there in place. It just needs the will for someone to sort out the nitty-gritty.
Okay. While you think through your next round of questions, just a couple comments. Douglas asked about the harmonization of legislation, not only with regard to pension reform, with regard to many issues in the region, we talk about harmonization. The reality is it does take a lot of time. In some cases, I know, for instance, we are doing things like developing a model law, which all countries try in their individual way to shape their laws in some way close to that, so that harmonization is a good ideal, but it often takes quite a long time for us, all these different islands in the region, to get there. And what happens really is that each country develops their own legislation, but we always do this mindful of what the other countries are doing in the region. So that is somewhere where I'm sure, but we are all mindful of what the other countries are doing as we make our changes here. The second thing I wanted to comment about is why are unions not involved? The bank is not seeking to exclude any group when it does exercises like these. And in fact, these things normally go up on the website at some point in time and people are free to comment on it. All stakeholders should have the opportunity to comment on it, and it is the general policy that the bank adopts. And along the line, you say, why didn't you get there first? You start someplace, unions will get some opportunity, labor will get some opportunity to comment on the legislation. And I might add that at this stage, we are really still working on the policy document, which precedes that. One other comment, there is sometimes perhaps a perception that the central bank is so different and apart. And in probably some ways it is, as it has to be as the monetary authority. But we are indeed mindful that regulations are not supposed to stifle production. And that is why generally we do adopt a consultative process, and we do try to hold discussions with the industry. We know that we are not the be-all and end-all of knowledge, and in fact, the industry knows its business, so we do go out there and try to get the information, and we will undertake to continue to do that. That having been said, can I have any other burning questions that people may have? This is the opportunity to come now and ask them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Tim, your comments just before this session ended actually has led me into this question that I have. Now, in the governor's presentation this morning, he indicated that right across the region, there are about 17 or 18 countries that have pension legislation. But right across the region, there is actual legislation in place for government employee pension plans. And one of the challenges that we have right now, and it came up in the presentation that was made by Charles, is that when you look at Barbados, the pension liability on the government's pension plan is about $4.5 billion. Now that equates to approximately 55% of Barbados' GDP. That's significant. And looking across the region, the number is estimated to anywhere between 18 to 30% on average. As you know, there's discussion going on now in the United Kingdom in relation to the estimated 1.3 trillion, I think that's the number that they're talking about, which is the unfunded liability on the government pension plan. I think in Jamaica as well, there's discussion, or soon to have discussion, on the green paper on government employee pension plan. And I think that has in about 18% of GDP. So maybe if you can comment on the sustainability of the government employee pension plan when you consider, if you use Barbados as an example, we have in our budget on annual basis about $120 million in our pay pensions, and that number is growing as persons leave, right, the whole issue of living longer, that number is going to increase. So, you know, the question, what is happening in Trinidad? Is that information available? And more importantly, is that sustainable in the long run when you consider the fiscal challenges that governments in the region are having, when you know that is an obligation that governments have to make to its employees?
Thank you.
My name is Enid December. I'm from CARICOM Secretariat. And I like the discussion on the harmonization of legislation and what is taking place and what is not taking place. We at the CARICOM Secretariat have been working on the harmonization of legislation in the financial services sector for a number of years. But what you find happen is that to get all member states to do the same thing at the same time is proving to be very difficult. We have the CARICOM Financial Services Agreement with a number of articles which is aimed at harmonization of the financial sector. One of the articles deal with portability of pensions across the region. In 2002, the Ministers of Finance in Belize agreed that where countries have speculative provisions in their act for domestic asset, that should be across the region. Domestic asset should be extended to mean investment in any CARICOM countries. That has not taken place. We have a model financial institutions bill that is still on the drawing board. We have a model securities bill that is still on the drawing board. We are now going through the Caribbean on a mission looking at education, training, certification in the financial services sector to facilitate the free movement of persons. We hope we will get somewhere with that. In terms of social security scheme and the benefits, that is already harmonized. If you move from Jamaica to Trinidad, you'll get your same pension benefits. That is the public benefits. But what we realize is that, yes, we are creating a single space, but at the end of the day, it boils down to the politicians and the advice they get from their technicians, who can wait on the slowest member. So it's a long process, and we have been working very diligently. Most of you here might have seen me across the region. We know one another because we've been hammering at this for a number of years, and I'm soon to be a pensioner. And I would really want to see the benefits when I move from Guyana back to Jamaica to get my pension benefits that I've worked long and hard in Guyana for. Thank you.
Thank you, Enid. I'm going to take one more question because time is running out on us and we do have a lunchtime presentation.
Madam Chair, yes. I'm sure your distinguished panel is well aware of the recent strides which have been made in legislative pension reform, especially in the United Kingdom, but also in certain other European countries, and of the great jurisprudence which that has spawned not only domestically, but also at the European Court of Justice. And I was just wondering, to what extent, bearing in mind what the Minister said, no island is an island, to what extent those ideas, which are meant to delineate and define matters at the cutting edge of the pensions industry, especially with relation to the duties of trustees, to what extent that has filtered into the debate and discussion on the Draft Pensions Act?
Tim, you
want to
do this?
Yeah, well, first, anyway.
I'm going to ask Tim, and that's going to be our last. Okay?
I'll break the habit of a lifetime and be brief. If I could take the second question first, actually, the lady from CARICOM Secretariat. I'm just a general observation on politics, and this is going to get me in trouble because the TV camera's on.
Don't get in trouble.
Politics and pensions. Turn your microphone on and say that then. They don't go together, as my esteemed colleague just said. They don't go together because pensions are very, very long term. And it's just the nature of politics that politics is a other than for exceptional politicians, politics is a short-term business. And so if we're truthful, long-term for most politicians is the day after the next election. And that's just the way it is. That's not a criticism of the individuals involved. That's just how politics works. So it does make life difficult with pensions. But the first question about the sustainability of government's pensions, that actually worries me a lot. Many, many years ago, I wrote a critique of the funding of Trinidad government pensions, or the lack of funding of Trinidad government pensions. And I know one of the phrases I used caught the eye. I described it as a financial iceberg, because every year when you have the budget presentation, you see the tip of it, and the Minister of Finance tells you how much has been spent on pensions each year. But that's only part of it. You don't see the 7/8 that is below the surface that the financial ship of state is going to run into one day when our children are on board. So I do have concerns that government pensions, the long-term cost hasn't been recognised, and that comes down to, and I'm not an expert in this area, but how government draws up its own financial accounting statements. It would still tend to be very much on a cash basis. Okay. Now, if accounting was done on an accruals basis, as companies draw up the financial statements, government would be accounting for the value of its pension promises, and the tools are there. International Accounting Standard number 19 tells you that you've got to go and look at what pensions you promised, and you've got to look at the difference between the value, or if you like, the cost of meeting those promises and how much money you've accumulated. So half of that calculation is easy in Trinidad. You've accumulated nothing, like in most countries, you don't fund for government pensions. But the other side of the balance sheet does need to be addressed. I've looked at it a few times in the past, and you just do some back of the envelope numbers, and you come up with conclusions like, if you look in the total stock of public sector debt issued by government and related bodies, both in TT dollars and, say, US dollar debt, and if you doubled it, that's roughly the order of magnitude of what has been promised to public servants, not just the ones who retire, but the ones who are going to retire. So I can't remember what the total debt stock is now, but it's a lot. So every time every month you promise a bit of extra pension to your current employees, that's effectively you're issuing a bond. You're just not bringing it on balance sheet. So the first step has to be a proper accounting for what the government's liabilities are. Now, there have been various attempts and projects to do that, but the results have never been published, to my mind. So the answers are probably there. Some Canadian consultants did a project on this 3 or 4 years ago. So the results will be there in Ministry of Finance, but I don't know what the answers are. Just to finish, those of you who are not in Trinidad, the government pays a means-tested senior citizens pension to people over age 65 of $3,000. Basically, the headline figure is $3,000 a month. And at various times, the level of it's got increased, particularly relatively close to elections, it gets increased. We used to start our training sessions for people doing financial reporting on financial reporting of pension benefits with a slide that basically said the senior citizens pension has just gone up to $3,000 a month. Do you know how much that has cost you as a taxpayer? And the answer we had on the slide when we did some back of the envelope conversations was calculations was it's increased government's long-term liabilities by about $900 million. So it's big numbers. It's numbers with lots and lots of zeros. And yes, I do fear for the costs of it down the road. And the first step is to find out what those costs are going to be. Okay. Thank you.